Thank you very much for coming to the annual Jeeves Lecture. I'm Keith Siller, I'm the Head of Psychology and Neuroscience, and I'm going to say virtually nothing except to introduce Professor Gary Taylor, who's here as the Deputy Principal, the Master of the United College, and someone who has a growing interest in visual perception and action. And Gary's going to do the formal introductions.
Okay. Thank you, Keith. And thank you for inviting me to welcome you all to the lecture. This is, I'm ashamed to say, I've been here 16 years, and this is the first Jeeves lecture I've been to. So I apologise to Professor Jeeves, who I've just met. So this lecture series has been going since 1996 in honour of Malcolm Jeeves, who founded the School of Psychology here in 1969, I believe. And Malcolm has obviously seeded a tremendous school here, which has grown and grown over the years, and you're going to hear the fruits of one of its members in a minute. And Malcolm was a very eminent psychologist, was also a vice principal of the university, and was vice president, was president of the Royal Society of Edinburgh. And having just had a short discussion with him, he's tuned into what's going on in the university and nationally and internationally at the moment, so that's terrific. So, as I say, this lecture series has been going since 1996, when the first Malcolm Jeeves lecture was given by Richard Gregory, the famous psychologist. And today we're continuing this tradition by inviting a very eminent psychologist who's one of our own. So Mel Goodale was born in England, but his family, I believe, moved to Canada quite early, and so his whole education was in Canada, and he graduated with a PhD from the University of Western Ontario. But then he came over to Oxford for a two-year fellowship, and then was persuaded by Malcolm Jeeves to come to St Andrews in 1971. And spent 7 years here. He was here till 1977 before returning to Canada. And during that time, he had a friend and companion who's been here for life, which is David Milner, who we're very pleased to welcome. And the two of them wrote a seminal paper. So I was doing a look on the internet before I came here to do my background reading. So I looked on Scopus, and discovered that Mel has an H index, for those of you who worry about these metrics, of 63, which is pretty good, that comes from 320 outputs, that's papers and books, and that have been cited almost 20,000 times. Now, if you go to the slightly inflated Google Scholar, you'll discover he has an H index of 78 and 32,000 citations. And then when you rank the papers by the number of citations, the very top paper is a paper between Mel and David Milner. And this was a 1992 paper in Trends in Neuroscience, which is entitled Visual Routes, Separate Visual Pathways for Perception and Action. And that's had over 2,500 citations. And that obviously is a reflection of something that is seminal in the field. And that's really going to be the origin of a lot of what Mel is going to talk about today, I believe. So we're extremely pleased to welcome you back to St Andrews, and to welcome David as well and his wife, Christine. And we look forward to your lecture. So we look forward.
Thank you very much. I must say it's an honor and a great delight to be here giving a Jeeves lecture. The first time I met Malcolm was in the hebdomadar room when he was interviewing me along with a lot of other serious folk about taking a fellowship here at St. Andrews. And afterwards he said, don't worry, the job is yours. And besides, there's lots of fly fishing here. And, I'll share this with you. He never did share this with me, but what he did do was to give me an enormous job, which was getting the Gaddy Animal Lab going. At the tender age of 27, I had to negotiate with the Home Office and with many other people to try and get this thing off the ground, from the ground up. And it was a great education for me to be thrust so early into the game of being not only a researcher, but someone who was taking some responsibility for putting a whole set of infrastructure together, and for that I'm eternally grateful. It served me well in later years when I went back to Canada. And of course, I'm delighted also to be giving this talk in front of my colleague David Milner, who joined the St. Andrews department a year ahead of me in 1970, and then I came in 1971. And I think about 2 years later, there were 10 of us, I think. We had a wonderful time together as young. I think all of us were under the age of 30, and then Roger came bumped us up a little in terms of our mean age, Roger Wales. But here we are, many years later, 40 years on. So, this is a cartoon of what most people think vision does, that vision paints a picture of the world outside. And of course, that can't be correct. I mean, there's not a little picture in our head which a little homunculus is looking at. Somehow vision does not work that way, and we can't talk about it that way. But vision does offer up a representation of the world. I mean, I do see people out there in chairs and so on. I see things beyond my body. So I do have a representation, a psychological representation, of the world beyond my skin. But even so, I would argue that vision didn't begin that way. Vision didn't begin as a system for delivering up a representation. It began as a system for the distal control of movement. And this is perhaps the most example of this. This is a euglena, and as you know, those of you who have taken biology, the euglena is a single-celled organism that lives in a pond, and when it's in a bright part of the pond, it doesn't move its flagellum very much, and when it's in a dark part of the pond, it moves its flagellum a lot. And so as a consequence, it tends to stay in that part of the pond where there's a good resource, light, that it can use for manufacturing food. Now, I don't think anybody would say the euglena sees the world, that the euglena has somewhere in those little organelles, a representation of the world. You don't have to talk that way about vision in the euglena. All you have to do is to say, well, light strikes some photochemical in a cytoplasm that produces changes in microtubules, the flagellum moves, and that's all you have to say. But in fact, I think if you get to vertebrates, you can talk to some degree in the same way, so that when you're talking, for example, about simple creatures like a frog, you can show that there are independent lines from the eye right down to the motor neurons that control the muscles that really are independent of one another, so that there are independent pathways, for example, that control prey catching in frogs. And these are largely separate from those that project from the retina to structures in the brain that control things like the visual control of locomotion, for example, around barriers. So if you really want to talk about creatures like frogs and other amphibia in terms of the evolution of vision in vertebrates, then you can perhaps say that vision is not a kind of monolithic system, but rather it's something which represents a kind of collection of visual motor modules that work semi-independently. They have to be coordinated to some degree, but semi-independently in the control of behavior. But of course, the important question is, what about us? I mean, are our visual pathways organized the same way? Well, I think even a cursory examination of the projections from the eye to the brain would suggest that yes, a lot of the behavior under visual control is organized the same way as it is in a frog, in the sense that there are independent pathways somewhere between 10 to 14, depending upon whether you're a lumper or a splitter as an anatomist, that actually control behavior. And so, for example, there's projections that peel off pretty early from the optic tract that go down to the hypothalamus that synchronize our circadian rhythms in the suprachiasmatic nucleus, the SCN, something that's working overtime right now in me because I'm jet-lagged and it's working hard to get me on the local light-dark cycle. And then there are a collection of nuclei that aren't very much studied in primate brain or human brain. The accessory optic tract, three separate nuclei that are sensitive to different planes of movement across the retina that are important for postural control, that they're actually paired with the axes of the semicircular canals, and they work together in the control of posture. There are a number of projections in the thalamus and in the areas anterior to the thalamus in the pretectal area that are important for locomotion and barrier avoidance. And of course, there's a structure in the midbrain, the superior colliculus, that's important for the control of saccades, these rapid eye movements that we make. But of course, most of the attention that has been paid to the visual system in the primate brain has focused on the projections from the lateral nucleus up into primary visual cortex and beyond, into what we now know are two relatively independent pathways that receive projections from primary visual cortex and other sources, the dorsal stream and the ventral stream. Now, historically, however, vision scientists, particularly psychologists, have essentially ignored all of that, and they've instead focused on psychophysics and studies of perception, where they've asked questions like, are these two things the same or different? And that's the kind of approach that many visual psychophysicists have taken. It's very powerful. It tells us a lot about what people see. But what it's telling us about what people consciously see, what their experiences are when you ask that kind of question. Psychophysics is essentially built around conscious report. And even in those studies that have done masking, where they've masked visual stimuli and primed behavior later by things that you don't see, at least theoretically, that visual information that's being masked is accessible to consciousness. And it's perceptual and cognitive in nature. So, except for eye movements, which have been studied a great deal, and mostly in terms of as an adjunct to understanding the world, because we move our eyes around to gain more information in perception, there's been almost, until the last three decades, historically, over the last 150 years, as professional experimental psychologists, there's been little attention to motor control. And it's important to remember that eyes don't act on the world. You can't change the world by moving your eyes. You can change information that you gather, but you don't act on the world. You don't change anything. Yeah, in order to change something, you have to move your limbs, or you have to move your body by moving your legs around, and so on. So although we look at things, it's our hands and limbs that actually interact with the world. And until the late 20th century, there were very few studies of how vision actually allows us to do this and what the neural substrates are for that control. But one important figure here is this man, Marc Genereau, who sadly died a few years ago. Marc, I had the great pleasure to meet professionally for the first time in 1982. He and Alan Hine invited me to a meeting in Lyon, and I think suitably we had the meeting here in Musée des Frères Lumière, where the motion picture camera was invented and motion pictures actually took off as a medium. It's a beautiful building. And I think it's interesting that in those days, of course, there's no video or anything of that kind, but Mark used a Bolex 16mm camera to record hand movement as people were reaching out and picking up objects. And what he found was that people scaled their hand mid-flight when they were reaching out to pick up objects. And he argued that the mechanisms that allowed you to transport your hand to an object were independent from those that actually controlled the size of the grasp that you used, the transport phase and the grasp phase. And I was fortunate enough to come back to Lyon for a sabbatical. I spent 5 months working in his lab with these two guys, Claude Prablon and Denis Pelisson. Denis was then a graduate student. He's now the director of the Inserm unit in Lyon. And we wrote a paper, much to our delight, we got it into Nature. And it was an experiment in which we simply had people looking and pointing to targets. It was very, very simple, and we were recording what they were doing. The trick was we jumped the target during the eye movement so that they didn't see the target jump. But nevertheless, they corrected beautifully. And what we found was that people, even when they were tested in the most rigorous psychophysics, couldn't tell you whether the target had jumped, but their hand corrected. So their hand knew something that they didn't. And we concluded that the neural mechanisms mediating the perception of target position can be dissociated from those mediating visually guided reaching movements directed at that target. And I went back to Western, where I was then based, and began to work. But of course, I still had lots of contact with the University of St. Andrews because of the 6 years or 7 years that I spent here. And of course, David and I were regularly corresponding. And of course, St. Andrews, I've got some pictures I'll show you here, was a world of great importance to me even after I left, because I would come back routinely. I can see some smiles out there, as some of you may recognize, younger versions of yourselves or your friends. Not all the pictures are younger, because it's very hard to find on the net pictures from 1978 or 77, I can tell you. I apologize for those whose pictures are not contemporaneous with the period that I spent here. Maybe you're glad of that, I don't know. But as I said, I had a wonderful time working with David Milner. And David told me about a patient that I'll introduce to you in a moment. In fact, brought her to my lab at Western. He came as well, and we studied her in great detail after he had published a seminal paper in Brain. And out of this work, I'll give you the punchline now, out of this work came this distinction between the functions of the dorsal and the ventral stream, the pathways you met earlier in my little boxology diagram. And what we argued was that there was evolutionary pressure for the development for a system that allowed us to perceive the world, that allowed us to think about the world, to make plans, to choose courses of action and so on, to talk about the world with our conspecifics. But at the same time, there was a visual system that allowed us, once we had determined the goal, to reach out and, for example, in this case, grab the goal, the coffee cup, appropriately. And that these two systems, vision for perception and vision for action, could be mapped on to two pathways that arose in early visual areas, one projecting dorsally up into the posterior parietal cortex, that was important in transforming visual coordinates into the movements that required for action, and another projecting down to the temporal lobe that was exquisitely positioned for constructing on the basis of visual input, on the basis of stored templates and knowledge about the world, a representation that we could use for thinking about that world. And of course, the patient that David introduced me to was a young woman at the time, DF, who suffered carbon monoxide poisoning from an improperly vented shower in a bathroom in a house that she and her partner were renovating. And this left her with what neurologists call visual form agnosia, which I'll explain in a moment. But what you can see in this much more recent MR, structural MR, reconstruction of her brain, she has bilateral lesions of an area in the ventral stream, area in the lateral occipital area, area LO, that we now know is very important for the recognition of the geometric structure of objects. And DF's most salient symptom, as I said, was visual form agnosia. But her clinical and psychophysical testing was essentially in the normal range. You couldn't explain her behavior by appealing to some low-level retinal problem or anything of that kind. So her deficit was so profound that when David held up a pencil in front of her and asked her what the orientation of the pencil was, she might say it's yellow because she still had preserved surface properties, but she couldn't tell him the orientation of the pencil, whether it was upright or on a slant or horizontal or whatever. But remarkably, when she reached out to grab the pencil, neither David nor I had the prescience to actually have a video camera running. This is just a fake picture. But what she did and what David noticed was that she oriented her hand in flight to grasp the pencil. So she was able to use orientation information to control her limb movements, despite the fact that she couldn't tell us the orientation of objects that were held up in front of her. So when you reach out to pick up an object, you don't just orient your hand to the orientation of the object you're going to pick up, What you also do is scale your hand to the size of the object, so that when you reach out to pick up this graduate cylinder, you don't open your hand as wide as you do when you reach out to pick up a beaker. So your hand automatically scales. You don't think about this. You don't say, that's a pretty large object. I better open my hand wider. There's none of this cognitive operation going on. It happens every day automatically. And of course, you can measure this in the lab. And we, as I said, brought DF to Canada, and we tested her on a number of different problems involving picking up objects or commenting on the size of objects and so on. And we attached little infrared light-emitting diodes to her fingers and her hand, and we could record and reconstruct the aperture that she used when she picked up objects. And we gave her two tasks in 1990 when she was over. We asked her to simply reach out and grasp an object, or we asked her to estimate its width. And this estimate, we argued, was really reporting on what it was that she saw, whereas the grasp, of course, was quite automatic. She was just asked to pick it up. And when you do this, and you can see in this simple graph here, when you compare her grasp to a 2.5 centimeter wide object with a 5 centimeter wide object, what you can see is that she opens her hand wider for the wide object in flight than she does for the narrow object. And she does this beautifully. On the other hand, when she's asked to report the size, basically she's all over the place from trial to trial. She can't tell you how big. She can't tell you verbally either. I mean, she just can't tell you what the size of the object is. And so it looks as though, again, she can scale her hand to the size of an object whose width she cannot report. So several years after that, actually several months after that, I met this lady, a patient RV, who had lesions not in the ventral stream, but in the dorsal stream. So she has lesions that actually involve the cortex right from the occipital pole up into the posterior parietal cortex, sparing primary visual cortex. So primary visual cortex was spared on the medial surface, but there was a lesion going up right into the posterior parietal cortex. So her dorsal stream was heavily compromised. And this was true in her right hemisphere and in her left hemisphere. And when we tested her on exactly the same thing as we tested DF, then what we see is essentially the opposite pattern. So that when she's asked to estimate, verbally, of course, she's absolutely accurate. She says, that's the narrow one, that's the wide one, and so on. But even with her hand, she does very well. She's not as good as a normal person. She's got a few problems in motor control. But what you can see is that she scales for the size of the narrow and the wide object. On the other hand, even though she knows the size, when she reaches out to pick it up, she opens her hand wide on every occasion. And she doesn't close down her hand until she makes tactile contact with it, and then she closes around it. So, this is what neuropsychologists like me and like David just die for. We love this. It's a double dissociation, where what you have is a patient who has damage in one structure, the ventral stream, who shows basically compromised perception of object features, but can use those same features to control her actions. And then you have a patient who has damage in the dorsal stream, who has compromised action control, but can perceive those features that don't seem to influence her grasping in this case. So that's all ancient history. So that all happened back in the early 90s. And then something happened during that period. And what I've done here is to go to PubMed, and I've done a Boolean search where I put in fMRI or functional magnetic resonance imaging, those words. And what you can see is that I gave up in 2010. But what you can see is that there's a very rapid growth here in the number of papers published every year using functional magnetic resonance imaging. And in 1992, there were two papers published. Hideo Sakata was the senior author He's tipped for a Nobel Prize. I mean, he's someone who may get one. Because this has essentially revolutionized cognitive neuroscience, to peer inside the brain of intact humans and find out what's going on. And another author on those two papers is a man called Ravi Menon, who is now the director of our imaging unit at Western Ontario. We were very lucky to scoop him in 1993, and we brought him to Western, and we had a 4T magnet going in 1994 that was one of only four in the world, and the only one in Canada. And so we stole a march on neuroimaging. We retired the old lady in 2006, sold her for scrap after, I think, that machine generated something like 480 papers. It was a great investment in top journals around the world. So it was great to have Ravi aboard. And that's when we were studying DF. Dave and I knew nothing about fMRI. It hadn't been invented. But in the early part of this century, we brought DF back to Canada, and we started to scan her brain and compare her brain with that of normal controls. And what you see here is a normal observer's brain, or a graduate student's brain. And what we see here is activation in this area when we contrast the activation associated with looking at intact pictures without color or anything versus scrambled versions. And what you can see is activation in area LO. And as you've already seen, the damage in DF's brain corresponds beautifully to those areas that are activated in the normal brain when you have them look at intact objects, when you have people look at intact objects. And indeed, if you do a slice through her brain, what you can see, even with this contrast in this room, you can see, although she's got enlarged sulci, there's actually missing tissue in area LO on both sides of her brain. Okay, so, you know, when you test her on intact line drawings versus scrambled ones, and of course the only route to understanding the object is form. There's no color or other cues from a line drawing. And of course, she doesn't recognize them for what they are. And of course, she also shows no differential activation in her brain. But if you look at a normal observer's brain, and you take the activation and you mathematically transform it and put it on her brain, what you can see is the activation in the normal brain actually corresponds to the location of the lesions in her brain. So it's not surprising that the early neuropsychology that we did turned out the way it did, because of course she's missing this area that's so important for the recognition of objects. So what about the things that she can do in the brain? That is, that she can convert visual information into obviously reasonably good control over her movements when she picks up objects. So we've been doing this for a number of years in normal observers in the lab, and we have a number of studies that have shown, as other labs have shown as well, that there's an area along the intraparietal sulcus that's important for the visual control of saccadic eye movements. We call it sometimes LIP plus, even though it's not on the lateral surface in the human as it is in the monkey, that's important for saccades. An area here in the back end of the posterior parietal cortex near the junction with the occipital lobe that's important for the control of reaching, the superior parietal occipital cortex. And an area, human anterior intraparietal sulcus, which is important for the control of grasping, the visual control of grasping. Now, this work was led by my then former postdoc, Jody Cullum, who's now, I'm happy to say, a full professor at Western. We didn't let her go because she's a really terrific researcher. And she devised a number of devices that allow us to study action in the magnet. It is not easy to study action in the magnet because your arms are paramagnetic. There's all kinds of problems with movement artifact and so on. So you have to invent some pretty clever designs, and you have to invent some pretty clever machinery. And it's pretty heroic stuff for both the experimenter and the subject in the magnet. So here you see a subject in our magnet, and the first thing you notice is the head is tilted, so they look directly at the objects that they're interacting with. You can't use mirrors or anything like that because you have real problems in control. You give instructions over headphones, and there's a microphone that they can use. You brace the top of the arm, and also you have this device here, which is, we call, the grasparatus, which basically, you can't use solenoids or anything electrical, so it's all driven by air pressure, pneumatics. And so there's little pistons in there, and it rotates this octagonal cylinder, and on each surface there is a shape that can be backlit with a super bright LED in the dark, and it's, obviously we photographed it in the light, and then the person can reach out and pick up that object. And when you do this, and you compare grasping with an unformed hand reaching, so you either grasp the object or you just touch it with the back of your knuckles, you don't point, you just reach your whole arm out, and you do the contrast, what you see is this area here in, as I've shown you earlier, the anterior intraparietal sulcus, AIP, that shows more activation for grasping than for reaching routinely. So, you know, another important thing to note is that there's no differential activation in LO. You don't have to analyze the shape of the object using LO in order to get your hand on the, it's done in situ in the dorsal stream. That's not to say you don't recognize it, but you recognize it as much on a reaching trial as you do on a grasping trial. Okay, so this is her brain flipped over, her cerebral hemispheres. And what you can see is LO is certainly damaged. But an important thing to note, in addition to the fact that she's got spared areas in her ventral stream, is that she's got damage elsewhere, which I'm going to show you in a moment. So what happens when DF grasps object in the magnet? So here we see that brain again. But I want to point out something here, that there is a lesion here in her dorsal stream. She had a lesion early on in her dorsal stream in the most posterior regions of the dorsal stream in an area that I showed you earlier called SPOC. It's important for the control of reaching. And recent work by David Milner and Holly Bridge at Oxford has shown that in fact this damage is now bilateral. It probably wasn't bilateral initially, but now, because we didn't see it at all, in those early scans in the 4T in the early part of the century. And so it looks like her brain has shown some changes here. And indeed, when you test her for reaching versus grasping, you see, just like you do in normal individuals who have intact brains, activation in the AIP area, despite the fact that she has these lesions in the more posterior regions of the dorsal stream. So that raises a really interesting puzzle, because we know from work in the monkey that there are projections from the caudal parts of the intraparietal sulcus up to AIP that carry a lot of information about the surface properties and shape of objects. So how is she able to do this, despite the fact that she has these lesions in the posterior regions? How is it that she's able to grasp objects and show normal activation in AIP? Well, there is a possibility, of course, that these projections are coming from somewhere else. And that's what I want to talk about now for the rest of the lecture. So if we go back to the boxology diagram, and for a moment, let's do something interesting. Let's take away primary visual cortex, like you might in a patient who has lesions of primary visual cortex. Larry Weiskranz, my postdoc supervisor at Oxford, studied many of these patients, and he invented a term. He loves puns, Larry, and he called it blindsight. And he's written chapters called Blindsight in Hindsight. And if you spend any time with Larry, you'll find out that this is not an unusual behavior for him. He loves puns. So if you look actually at the projections from the eye, to the dorsal and to some degree to the ventral stream, what you can see that is that there are projections from the eye to the interlaminar regions of the lateral geniculate nucleus that also reach MT plus, the middle temporal area that we know is important for motion vision, but is also conveys information to the dorsal stream and certainly a little bit to the ventral stream. There are projections that go to the colliculus and then up into the LGN and then to that same MT. There are projections that go to the pulvinar as well from the colliculus and up to the dorsal and ventral stream, probably mostly the dorsal stream in this case. And there are projections that go directly from the eye to the pulvinar that go up into MT. Now, these projections are very prevalent in young animals. They tend to retreat, but they're still present in the marmoset and other primate brains. So, we've been studying another patient, and I wanted to introduce you to her. She's from Scotland, and she, when we tested her, was 40. She went to the doctor complaining of a sore shoulder, and she got some paracetamol, I think you call it, and went home, but it turned out she had a respiratory infection, and she went into respiratory collapse and ended up in a coma for 2 months. And sometime during that period, she had a stroke, or strokes, that left her with large bilateral infarctions in her occipital lobe. She's completely blind in static perimetry, and she uses a white cane. I'm going to show you her lesions. If you're used to looking at these kinds of pictures, you'll be amazed at how large her lesion is. It's a very, very big lesion. And here's the occipital, missing occipital lobe, essentially. There's sparing here, as you can see, of the right parahippocampal cortex. There's a tiny tag of tissue at the very, very end of the calcarine, but it doesn't seem to function because on static perimetry she doesn't show any sensitivity. And there's actually damage in the right dorsal stream in the posterior parietal cortex, unilaterally. Okay, here she is. So she's doing pretty well. Okay, so you can see that that she's doing remarkably well at catching moving balls. I will say that she actually sees motion, so that she has a kind of unformed sense of motion, what is sometimes called Riddick's phenomenon, because of all those projections I mentioned to you, some of which leak down into the ventral stream, motion is often spared with large bilateral lesions of occipital cortex. And the neurologist Riddick noticed this in the early part of the 20th century. So she actually shows activation of MT. This is work that was done at Maastricht. We took her there, it was closer. And what you can see is right on the edge of the lesion there, there's activation for MT in both hemispheres, despite the fact that she has these very large lesions in her occipital lobe, including most of the ventral stream. So how does she do with static objects when she's asked to, for example, distinguish between them? In the world's simplest discrimination, these are so-called Ephron blocks that all have the same surface area, but they differ in their dimensions. And you present them in pairs, and all she has to do is to say same or different. And she's at chance. She can't do this. If you asked her to estimate the size, these are the estimates along the vertical axis and the size along the horizontal, and you can see basically she can't tell you the size of the objects. Not surprising, in static perimetry, she doesn't report static lights. What happens when you ask her to reach out and grasp the object? Well, what happens is this. Things tighten up, and she shows a significant slope. She opens her hand wider for the bigger object than she does the small object. So what brain areas are mediating this, then? If she's able to grasp objects whose size she cannot estimate, she has these massive lesions in V1, is the dorsal stream still working? And the answer is yes. if you ask her to reach out and pick up objects with her right hand, and you compare it with three conditions, grasping, reaching and touching with the knuckles, or just fixating, what you can see is that she shows more activation for grasping in AIP than she does for reaching and fixation. And in the left hemisphere, she's reaching with her right hand, she shows activation in SPOC, in this reaching area, for both grasping and reaching, because grasping involves reaching, and of course reaching involves reaching, and she shows activation there compared to fixation. So she's showing normal activation in her dorsal stream despite these massive lesions of the normal projections from V1 to the ventral stream. So this suggests that retinal input may reach the dorsal stream via pathways outside the geniculostriate pathway. I've left a bit of the talk out because I know I was going to run over. And I just wanted to say that what we're doing now to follow this up to some degree, in addition to doing DTI in her, we're studying a marmoset model now where we've trained the monkey. Didn't take much training to train the marmoset to do this. It just reaches out and picks up food objects of different sizes, and it scales. But I'm collaborating with a man called James Bourne, who's a Monash, and we're putting in optogenetics into the using optogenetics, putting in stuff that'll make the neuron turn on and off to when you put the light on it, and we can insert using a rat probe, because the marmoset's brain is very small, a light guide down there to turn off the pulvinar and other structures and see what happens to grasping. And if I'm invited back, not to give a Jeeves lecture, if I'm invited back at any time, I think in the next 12 months, I should be able to tell you what's happening. But needless to say, even though it looks as though grasping can take place without V1, it really raises a kind of question here. There are massive inputs from V1 into the dorsal stream. What in the heck are they doing if you can grasp without V1? And one possibility is size constancy. Now, size constancy is very easy to understand. You're all psychologists, or many of you are. When I move towards David Milner, he stays the same size, even though his retinal image is getting bigger and bigger on my retina. And I'm glad he doesn't change size. He doesn't shrink when I move back. So it's the fact that things look the same size despite the viewing distance. We equate for the viewing distance, and we have size constancy. And Father Ted can tell you all about it. He's actually explaining this to his rather dumb friend.
Okay, one last time. These are small. But the ones out there are far away. Small, far away.
So he clearly doesn't have size constancy without a lot of work. So yeah, size constancy is the fact that when you look at a small object, a small toy cow, and you then look at a real cow that's at the right distance away, they can actually have the same retinal image size, and yet they're clearly, and you know that when you look at them, one is bigger than the other. And similarly, when you take the toy cow and you move it further away, it gets a smaller image on your retina. But still, nevertheless, you see the cow as not changing in size, the toy cow. And you can use pictorial cues. You don't have to rely on things like vergence or accommodation, which of course are very, very important. You can also use pictorial cues. This is a famous painting by Gustave Calbot, and Rainy Day in Paris. And the people there at the back look to be the same size as the people in the foreground in this very photographic painting. And because, of course, you see all the depth cues there, all the pictorial depth cues. But if you take them and you bring them down here, suddenly they look really tiny. And of course, because the only way you can explain that is if they are the world's smallest midgets, because the pictorial cues are telling you that they're in the same plane as the people in the larger people in the foreground. So really the question that we wanted to address was, is there evidence for size constancy mechanisms operating in V1? It might be possible that V1 makes some kind of contribution there, because almost all of the tests that have been done on these patients with V1 lesions have involved putting the object at the same distance every time. It makes it easy. They then, you know, you just change the size and they reach to the same place. They were never being pushed in terms of relying on object constancy. And there was an experiment done, a beautiful experiment by Scott Murray and Dan Kirsten, published in Nature Neuroscience back in 2006, in which they took advantage of the Ponzo illusion, which is basically an illusion that was also in that picture you saw earlier, where the object that's further away in this pictorial diagram here appears to be larger than this object here. And when they did this in fMRI, they found that they had larger activation in V1 for the object that appeared larger, even though it was the same retinal image size. So even in V1, which traditionally thought to reflect what's happening in the retina, was showing activation that was correlated with the real size of objects rather than the retinal image size. Now, of course, doing that experiment with a pictorial illusion is a pretty weak effect, because pictorial illusions have a strength of somewhere between 10 to 35%. They don't really make that object look that much larger than it really is. But what you can do is to take advantage of the after image, which does show 100% effect. Do you know an after image? I think you're familiar with. It's an unchanging image on the retina. You know, you've been to a wedding, a flashbulb goes off, and then you look around and you see a gray spot somewhere. You can even make someone's head disappear by doing that. So if you take an after image, here's one. Stare at the red cross there. Stare at the red cross. Give up some of my time. Keep staring. And now you should have an aesthetic experience. Right, so you should see the Mona Lisa, right? Okay, you can have, if you're a Canadian, a patriotic experience. It doesn't take nearly as long, actually. You can. There we are. Okay, so the thing about after images is that if you present a stimulus here, where that green bar is, if you present a stimulus here, and then you create an after image by having a bright light there, and then you present a surface on which you can put that after image, it appears to be bigger than if you present it on a surface that's closer. So that was the paradigm that, as I'll show you, we exploited. And you can experience this now. If you actually have anything white or anything that's a pale color in front of you in addition to the screen, you can stare at that spot for a while and then look at the screen and then look at that piece of paper on your lap or whatever, and you will see that the image will change size. Okay, so you see it there. You see how big it is, and then when you look at something that's closer to you, it will appear to be smaller. In fact, it's 100% effect, because it looks like it's stuck on the screen, and it looks like it's stuck on the paper. So, when I say that we did this, I really mean that they did this. Irene Sparandio, who was my postdoc, she's now at the University of East Anglia, she's a lecturer there, and Philippe Schrenard, who was a postdoc and is now at La Trobe University in Australia. And what we did was this. We had people view after images at different distances in the scanner. And to do this, we would present a super bright light here for a few seconds and create an after image. They would stare at it. And then that would flip down that surface, and they would have here another surface that could be closer or further away, and they projected the after image onto that. And then we measured fMRI activity in early visual areas. And what I've done here is to just show you what happens. So here are the perceived sizes of the after image. Here are the different distances on which they were projecting the afterimage. And what you can see is that activity increases as a function of viewing distance. And we've done all the proper controls for vergence and accommodation and everything else. So what you see is that the activity in V1 reflects the real size of the afterimage rather than the retinal image size. And the great thing about afterimages, I recommend them highly, is that they have the same time signature as bold, as the activity in the brain. They last about, they take a few seconds to start. They don't come right away. Last for anywhere between 4 to 8 seconds, and then they go away. And so you can correlate the bold with the afterimage reports. They press a button when they first see the afterimage. They let their finger go when they stop seeing it. And you get a lovely 0.98 correlation between the afterimage duration and the bold signal. So it's a beautiful thing to work with. Okay, so retinotopic activity in V1 reflects the perceived, not the retinal image size of a visual stimulus. This could reflect the operation of size constancy mechanisms. What about grip constancy? I mean, we have grip constancy. If I have an object here and I reach for it, I open my hand roughly the same amount, slightly more, because I've got a bit more time to open my hand. But I scale my hand to the size, the real world size of the object, not the retinal image size. So I have, if you like, size constancy for grasping, grip constancy. So what happens when you go back and test MC now in this kind of test? Now, what I have to say about MC is that if you give her a very bright white object, she can see it. She can't tell you how big it is, and I'll just show you that, but she can see it. She can tell you how big it is in the sense that it's either filling, it's big in the sense that it's bright when it's close, and it's big and bright when it's close, and it's small and not so bright when it's far away. But she can't tell you the real size or width of that object. So we did some experiments. When I say we, I mean they. Robert Whitwell and Irene Sparandio. Robert is now a postdoc with Jim Enns at UBC. And we used EEPROM blocks again that have the same surface area but different widths. MC can't recognize the form of objects, so all these objects for her appear to be the same size, these bright objects. And so what we did was we presented them to her at different distances, and what we did was to test a bunch of controls. And what you can see is that it's obviously for controls a trivial task. It looks to be the same, all those objects look to be the same width, even though they're at different viewing distances. I mean, you just move them further away, oh yeah, they're the same width, and they open their hand the same amount, no big deal. But what she does is rather interesting. What she does is the further away it is, the smaller it looks. And she can't scale for distance. So she reports the width as being not so wide when it's further away than when it's close. And then we just changed the task, presented to her the stimuli in exactly the same way, and asked her to scale her grasp. And we found something very different in the grasping task. For the normals, of course, again, they scaled. They show grip constancy. And so did she. So that means that V1, in the case of grip, we think, is not contributing to grip constancy. Very interesting puzzle. Now, it could be, and this is possible, Smets and Brenner have suggested in a very thought-provoking paper that maybe grasping an object does not involve scaling your hand to the size of the object, but really figuring out where to put your thumb and your finger. So you're going double pointing. You're pointing to one edge of the object with your thumb and another edge of the object with your finger. Maybe that's what's going on. And so, if you like, grip scaling is an epiphenomenon of double pointing. That could be true. There are reasons to believe it's not true. But there are reasons to believe it's true as well. So it's an open question. which leads me to my last paragraph there, it could also mean the grip scaling for object size can be computed independently of the genicular stripe pathway. It could be that too. We don't know. And that's I'm glad we don't know, because it gives me more work to do. We can actually pursue this. So that's really the end of my talk. I wanted to say that the duplex model that David and I developed, I believe, can explain the patterns of deficits and spared visual abilities in a broad range of patients. And it does assist in diagnosis and trying to understand what their problems are, and in rehab, in getting people to rely more, if they have an intact visual motor control system, rely more on it and not be defeated entirely by what they see. And DF certainly behaves that way around her kitchen and so on. So there are some important implications for understanding neurological patients. And of course, there's also importance for the design of robots and computer vision systems as well, because it's not, I believe, the first time that biological principles can inform engineering design. I might also add that it's being used to try and understand the functional organization of other sensory systems, such as audition and somatosensation. And indeed, Chris Dykerman, who worked with David, and Edward DeHaan have proposed that somatosensory control for haptics, recognizing objects by feel, involves different pathways than the sensory motor control for reaching and grasping. So I'll return to Santiago Ramon y Cajal, who I think reminds us all that our brain is an organ of action that's directed toward practical tasks. I think sometimes as psychologists, we forget in getting all wrapped up in perception and memory and cognition that the brain is ultimately an organ that controls our movement. And without movement, our brains cannot be thrust into the next generation, because natural selection can only work on the products of action, not on the products of thought. You have to do something. To use a hockey analogy, a Canadian hockey analogy, you can do all the fancy skating you like. What counts is a puck in the net. You know, you've got to do it that way. Anyway, thanks for your attention.
It is traditional for, if you're able to answer some questions before we go for some refreshments or open this to questions. Yes?
The dissociation between vision and net is, of course, very prominent, but it's not, they're not separate, of course. There are interactions between the dorsal and ventral streams. For example, the cream and profit literature, where you don't grab a hammer by the end, you grab it by the handle, or a brush, you don't grab it by the bristles, right? You
Absolutely.
Grab it by the handle. So there must be some sort of...
there is. So, and a terrific question. So we've been studying that on two fronts. One is to look at patients like DF, of course. And what DF does is to pick up hammers exquisitely well, but functionally poorly. So if you give her a hammer with the business end facing her, she'll pick it up like a stick, you know, and end up with the hammer down here. And similarly, most recently, my postdoc, Zhuan Chen, who came to me from Feng Feng's lab in Beijing, has been using dynamic causal modeling, looking at the interconnections between the dorsal and ventral stream when people are recognizing tools versus elongated objects and so on, or stubby tools versus stubby objects. And what she finds is that when they're dealing with tools and recognizing them, we can see an increase in the reciprocal connections between the dorsal and ventral stream. So you're absolutely right that the two are not, to again use a Canadian metaphor, they're not two solitudes, talking about Quebec and the rest of Canada. They need to work together. Right?
So you did look at that for patients, you looked at their...
Yes, yeah. Yeah, and David and David Carey have also done experiments along those lines as well, so that there are clearly limitations to what the dorsal stream can do. And indeed, it looks as though the dorsal stream likes the primary axis of objects quite a bit and works with that. an experiment I did, it seems like 1,000 years ago, Dave Parrott, and I did some experiments. He sent me a bunch of stuff to take to Italy to test DF, and also I tested her in Canada as well. If you give her the following tasks, for example, you have like these kids' toys, these posting toys, where you have to put a triangle or a circle through through the same shape opening. We gave her a T-shaped slot. If you give her a single slot, she can orient her hand beautifully and stick her hand in just along that primary axis. She does it beautifully well. If you give her a T-shaped object in her hand where the T is like this and she's hanging onto the stem, she knows it's a T, and you give her a T-shaped slot, then what she does is she gets it absolutely right or absolutely wrong. So she tries to post it either into the stem or into the top part of the T. It's as though on its own, the dorsal stream can sort of handle an object part with a primary axis, but can't integrate them.
If someone's saying that neural control movement, I like your paper messages at the end there. The question I had was, how much might plasticity play a role in, or complicate your interpretation of these patients where you have, you know, a small pathway remaining? We know in all other systems like in the spinal, you get a massive amount of recovered function in
power. Yeah, it always complicates it. And we know that early lesions, of course, there's a lot more recovery in both animals. Beautiful work by Steve Lombard and the cat showing blind sight recovery or visual recovery, and more blind sight in cats that get lesions early on than later. So yes, there has to be a role for plasticity here. In DF, I think even right from the get-go, when we tested her only a year or so after the lesion, the damage, she was doing very well. That's a short time in human brain growth for new pathways to get instantiated. But it's always a problem in interpreting things. And also, not just recovery, but also compensation, because you learn to solve problems in other ways. And, for example, MC, who has spared conscious motion, she's learned, actually, her daughter, who's known her no other way, her daughter was 2 when she had the stroke while she was in a coma, who's now, she's in her teens. She has been training her mom to recognize giant letters on a piece of A4, and you have a big capital A and a big capital B. And she'll look back and forth like this for a long time, and then she'll say P, and she's right. She somehow learned a motion signature for each of those letters. But I wouldn't say she's perceiving them, I mean, in this conventional sense of what we mean by perceive. So it's always important to keep the reorganization.
I think that's the other matter of even redundancy of pathways. You know, you assume that right. Still good.
Yeah. There are. I don't believe, however, that, say, the projections from pulvinar to dorsal stream, say, are there just in case you have a V1 lesion. I mean, I think they're doing a job in us as well. And so it's not, I don't believe it's redundancy in the sense of predicting that one day you're going to have a stroke and you might need something else. I don't think it looks that far ahead. Natural selection.
You talked about interception. What about situations where you have to make like a conscious decision, like crossing a road? Uh-huh. In that case, you've got the same perception information, but it feels like more of a perceptual task than interception. If you have to make a conscious decision, is that a different kind of pathway?
Well, philosophers, of course, make a distinction between P consciousness and A consciousness, and the notion access consciousness and phenomenal consciousness, the notion that you're conscious of something, you must be, you have some awareness, because when the fridge turns off, you suddenly realize, oh, the fridge has been going for a very long time. You know, you've got this impression of things, but it's pretty low level. But then you have this really high order thing when you're putting all of that to use, where you're crossing the road, as you say, or you're reading a book or something of that kind. So I think there's low level processing of which you needn't be aware. And we know this through lots of semantic priming studies where you give a word that people don't see, that's backward masked, and then if you get them to do a stem completion task, they'll come up with that word that they didn't see. So I'm not trying to suggest that the ventral stream is always generating conscious percepts of the access kind, but it is doing processing that can be put to use in these perceptual tasks. I don't know whether that answered your question. But.
Dave?
I won't formulate the question very well, but what about the other side of this? Because you consider perception and the dorsal stream, the ventral stream.
Yeah.
But just in answer to the Glaswegian woman who mm-hmm. is patently blind, when you refer to her seeing, you almost deny that it can be anything that's perceptual, because you say she sees some kind of letter, she sees movement. But I think you take the position that that can't be perception, and yet.
What I mean is it can't be perception in the sense that we see the letter A.
Well, but when we see the letter A, we have a lot more brain active. We can see its color, we can see its shape. And of course, her perception can't be equivalent to our own.
Right.
But, I mean, what she experiences.
I don't mean to demean her experience. I'm just saying that it's a different experience than our experience.
I mean, I'm trying to force you into a box of saying, well, the dorsal stream.
I don't think that's the. I see what you're doing here. No, it's an interesting argument. And Dave and I have written about this. I think part of the problem is that MT by anatomists is traditionally put into the dorsal stream. And so MT, which happens to be not in the posterior parietal cortex, by the way, but down, as its name refers, in the middle temporal gyrus, it feeds both the dorsal and the ventral stream. So it's, if you like, it's kind of like a V1 for vision. It provides basic motion processing that can then be worked on by other systems for either action control or for structure from motion, things of that kind. And I think in the case of MC, those few spare projections that she has to her ventral stream that allow her to experience motion, to have this Riddick's phenomenon, can be capitalized on to give differential reports. And I don't think that's using the dorsal stream. I think it's using MT, but I wouldn't call MT part of the dorsal stream in the way that we are talking about it, that is, as a system for converting visual information into the required coordinates for action. That happens later.
I really like the sort of evolutionary lens that you talk about all of this with, and I wondered if you could talk about what is the evolutionary significance of the ventral stream. So if all that matters is a puck in the back of the neck, why do you have a ventral stream if you don't have to take part in psychophysics experiments?
We certainly didn't, one would hope, evolve it to watch television or have psychophysicists study us. The reason I brought up television is that television is a wonderful example to use to show how flexible the ventral stream is, because we can watch television, in which it's, these days I guess it's much bigger, but it's a small screen and people are very tiny and you're not in charge of the camera, but you make great sense of it. So it's working in a frames of reference that are very different from action. You couldn't use it for action. I think it's important for modeling the world and thinking more deeply about the world. I think it probably is developed highly in very social animals that have shared experiences that they're going to communicate with one another and so on. I imagine there's been a big hypertrophy of the ventral stream in humans, particularly the end that uses memory and so on in the anterior pole of the temporal lobe to sort of bootstrap the bottom-up input that comes from early visual areas to the ventral stream. So action planning, recognition of complex objects, choosing between different courses of action, even modeling, like if I did this, maybe this would happen. Having an internal life where we can imagine things and rotate them and so on. I think if I take this log, it might fit across that stream, that kind of thing.
Okay.
Well, I think it's probably true to say that you deserve to wet your whistle.
I can exercise my grasping.
Check her grip size for beverages.
Right.
Thank you all for coming. Thank you, Mel, for a wonderful lecture. I hope you will come back. It's an open invitation. You're welcome back anytime
to
come and give us an update. There is a drinks reception somewhere in the building. I think it's either in the coffee room or perhaps down in the foyer, but I've forgotten. But we'll
I know where neither of those is.
Follow my lead. And thank you very much for getting frogs into the start of your lecture.
My pleasure.
I didn't set you up. thank you for a fantastic Jeeves lecture.
Thank you. Yeah.